those of you that made it this morning, I know we've got a lot of people out of town, a lot of people on the road today. So let's keep them in our prayers. But before we get started this morning, let's all stand up and greet our neighbors. Well, it's good to see each of you this morning. I just want to remind you that Jennifer's got a list of ministries that need to be chaired before fall. So we're asking you for some help. You know, it's amazing that we have such a fine group of leaders in this church. But more than ever, we're going to need some help. And I just want to say this. You're going to have to give your support to Matt and Jennifer. They're going to need help like no other. Once I'm gone, they're just going to need support and help and people taking over these ministries so that they don't have to cover every spot themselves, or even feel like they have to cover every spot themselves. So if you're aware of those ministry spots, pray about taking one of them over. If not, see Jennifer or myself or Matt, see somebody, and we'll help you find the place that's right for you. God bless you this morning as we worship together. We're going to have a great time worshiping the Lord today. It's good to see each and every one of you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Saint Church is involved in a fundraiser for Serenity Pregnancy Resource Center in the chapel in the foyer as the baby bottles collects for change. Bottles may be returned on Father's Day. Please see the insert in today's bulletin for more information. Also in the foyer are boxes of food. They have expired dates on them, but they're still good. If you'd like to take some of that, please go ahead and take that. Every young woman and young man's battle classes will continue next Sunday, June 6th, at the church at 5:30. Melissa Heffenheider and Sarah Longer will be leading the young ladies group, and Pastor Roger and Brett Muir will be leading the young men's. Please join us on Sunday, June 13th, for this Leadership Sunday. Our consistory will bless us with leading the entire service. Our consistory Vice President, Don Rayburn, will bring the morning message. Father's Day is Sunday, June 20th. We would like to bless our dads with a box of homemade cookies. There's a sign-up sheet in the foyer if you can help with that. Your help would also be appreciated to help box the cookies. Saturday, June 19th at 10:30 in the morning. As a reminder, tomorrow is Memorial Day. In observance of the holiday, the church office will be closed, but we'll open again Tuesday at 9. Jennifer is out of the office this week, but Deneen 6 will be in the office to help cover phones. In your bulletin is an insert. BDS is June 28th through July 1st. They're still looking for help, volunteers, so if you're felt led to do that, please do that. Are there any other announcements?
Yes, also a reminder, we have our membership class next week, right after church, lasts maybe 2 hours, where we'll have food, and it's basically a time where if you want to become a member of the church, you just come, you learn about the various ministries that you can be involved in, just what we're about, what our church is about, and just some of our leaders, and you get to meet some of them, and it's just a good time of fellowship. So if you attend this church and you want to be a member and have a say, this is an excellent opportunity to become a member, and that's next Sunday after the service. Thank you.
distinct privilege of going over to Serenity Pregnancy Resource Center in Powell a few weeks ago to pick up the bottles. And the location in Powell is one of their new ones, and I was overly impressed. They had volunteers who helped decorate, paint, do everything needed. But the two areas that impressed me the most were the ultrasound machine. They said there's only been a couple ladies who wouldn't look, but that is one of the biggest reasons they choose life, is when they get to see that baby in there and that heartbeat. Another one was their closet. Their closet was stocked full of diapers, onesies, blankets, toys. They had baskets full for the moms who go through the Earn While You Learn program. And they also had larger prizes, like strollers and stuff. So this is where our bottle money goes. Whenever we put change in there, money in there, we give it to them. This is how they bless the community, the ladies who are wondering what to do. And we thank you for what you do for that. So.
Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for bringing us all together, Lord, that we might worship in your name, Father. I pray, Lord, that you be with each and every one of us as we continue through this service, Lord. I pray this in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
So our call to worship today is Psalms 150. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and the lyre. Praise him with tremble and dancing. Praise him with the strings and the pipes. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with the resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Will you please stand? The head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for the body just as Christ does for the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. Thus ends the reading.
Please join me in what it is that we believe.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one holy universal Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Would you join me in how the Lord taught us to pray? Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
praises to our God.
Be the meaning in the air, in the sweet, sweet by and by. I'm a
Ask that you be with Nate Johnson with his upcoming surgeries.
But we want to praise you for the surgeries had, they're successful. We want to praise you for the healings we've had in this congregation. Lord, Tim Titus just comes to mind, just someone that you just restored and made vital, someone who was brought down so low. So we thank you so much for that, and we know you're a great healer. And Lord, finally, we want to, this morning, thank you for those men and women who were willing to lay down their lives for the sake of others, for the love of others, something with which you are more familiar with than any other. So Lord, we want to thank you and honor your name for giving us these wonderful people. And Lord, we just want to express that they've been such a blessing in our life and willing to do this for us. And help us to not forget their heroism and remind us to thank their family members and those they've served with. And Lord, finally, we ask that you please be with the remainder of this service. Use these songs well, use our fellowship well, and use the message well to ultimately build each of us up so that we can be conformed to the image of your Son and bind us in unity through the power of your Holy Spirit. And these things we praise and ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Before we get started, how many of you serve in one of the branches of our services? Let's see your hand. Raise your hand real high. Look at that. Praise God. Let's give them a hand. It reminds me of a plaque that I saw one time in the foyer of a church that we served in East Texas. And I heard a little guy ask his dad, he said, "Dad, what's that plaque for?" He said, "Well, that's for people who have died in the service." He said, "Really?" He said, "Did they die in the early service or the late service?" You know, I want to continue this series on the attack on the family. Culture is attacking the standard, God's standard for family and for marriage and for men to be men and women to be women, and has done an excellent job. I pulled out this book. I had it ordered. I had a copy of it somewhere, but I couldn't find it. So this book's over 40 years old. The man that I worked for over 15 years, James Robinson, wrote it, and it's called The Attack on the Family. And if you want to borrow it, you're more than welcome to use it. Over 40 years old, James also did a primetime two-hour special on all the networks except ABC, and ABC had already kicked him off the air because he said homosexuality was a sin. Now, they didn't say anything about that. He also said that adultery was a sin, that he named a whole list of sins. But they picked that one thing out and said, "You will not say that on our network." That was the beginning of the downturn of culture invading biblical family values. This week, I did this on purpose. I watched some of the TV shows that I just normally watch with this in mind. What am I going to see that is anti-family? And am I willing to watch that, or am I going to turn it off? Wednesday night, and I won't tell you the names of the shows, but I like cop shows and high action shows. I like the stuff that gets your blood pumping. But I was watching this one show, and in the middle of it, they have two men serving in a police force that are dating, and it showed these two men kissing. I had to turn the TV off. Couldn't take it. That was Wednesday night. Thursday night. Again, a police showed. Two women, and they had had a child by a surrogate. And so one of these women, they were married, by the way, and one of these women were pregnant. And the one that was not pregnant started rubbing the belly of the one that was pregnant, and I thought I was going to throw up. And then they started kissing. And again, I had to turn the TV off. After further reflection, I realized that I did not turn the TV off when there were couples living together. I did not turn the TV off when there were other forms of sin that were blatantly being thrown in the face of, this is primetime TV and there's kids watching. You know there are. I know there are. And that these kids are seeing these blatantly open, sinful relationships, and what are we doing about it? For the most part, nothing. Now, I want you to read this passage of Scripture with me, because it is very important in the world in which we live in. Starting with verse number 21 of Ephesians chapter 5. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Now, that may not seem like an important verse, but as we begin to go down these other verses, it's going to become quite important. One thing that I have found in my life is the minute that I stop submitting to the people who have the ability to mentor in my life, the people who have the ability to speak into my life, I begin to take this downhill slide, and I start letting things like TV shows, movies, other types of entertainment come in, and I begin to watch stuff that I shouldn't watch. I'm confessing to you today. So I resubmitted myself yesterday to the men that I consider to be my mentors, and I said, you need to hold me accountable to what I watch. It wasn't easy to do, because I like some of those high-action police shows. I enjoy them. But I knew I needed to submit to them. I knew that I needed somebody to say, what have you been watching this week? How much time have you spent in the Word this week? How much time have you spent reading the Bible with your family this week? Now, it goes on to say this, wives, submit to your husband as to the Lord. Now, this has become one of the most hated verses by women in churches all across the country. And I will tell you why it's become hated. It's become hated because it's been wrongly defined and it's been abused. You know, I used to kid my wife when we would get into an argument and I was beginning to lose. I would just say, woman, submit. That went over about like, it just didn't go over at all. And I learned that if I really wanted to stir the pot and have a knockdown, drag-out fight, that was the way to start it. But I had a near 90-year-old man who taught me this. And I hope you will learn something from it today also. He said, if you will look throughout the preponderance of Scripture, he said, you will find that any time that God is using this word submit, he is telling us to give of ourselves with passion. Now, think about that, ladies. as God is asking you to submit to your husbands. If you give of yourself with passion, it's very difficult for a man to take advantage of that. Men, if you do take advantage of that, you're sick. You really are and need help. I would encourage you to get into counseling as soon as possible, because you are going to blow your marriage apart if you take advantage of a woman who's willing to give herself with passion to you, and yet you still abuse that term, submit. Think about it. Did God abuse it? Did he use it as a tool to manipulate, or did he use it as a tool to drop the axe handle on our heads to get us in line? No, he did not. He, of all people, gave of himself with passion to each and every one of us. And we should take and follow that example. And that's not just for husbands, but that is also for wives. And no doubt that wives, you have a role to submit yourselves to your husband spiritually. He is the spiritual leader of your house. But husbands, you have the role and you have the responsibility to never take advantage of that. You should be the protector of your wife. In fact, let's see if I can find it real quick. First Peter chapter number 4, I believe. Number 3. Wives, in the same way, be submissive to your husbands, so that if any of them do not believe the word, they may be won over without words by the behavior of their wives, when they see the purity and reverence of your lives. Wives, you can win your husbands to the Lord if they're unbelievers by your ability to give of yourself with passion. And if we were to continue reading, we'd find out that husbands, if you want your prayers to be heard, if you want them to go further than the ceiling in your home, you will pay respect to your wife and love your wife like Christ loves the church. Let's read a little more in Ephesians. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church. I'm reading from verse 23, now 24. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Now, there was, I'll never forget this day. There was a day that Diana and I had a falling out and we were not getting along. And the thing about it was, I knew I was right. I knew it. I was right. And I was going to get my point across. Come hell or high water, I was going to get my point across. By the way, guys, I failed at that miserably. Second of all, I was led to this verse, and I read it, and husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. And I heard this still small voice say, do I only love you on the days that you're right? Do I only love you on the days that you're doing everything like you're supposed to do? Or do I love you every day, no matter what? And I started crying like a little baby because I realized I did not love my wife that way. And I had to change. Again, I went to one of my mentors and asked him to pray with me on this and hold me accountable on it. I had to change the way that I love my wife. I had to love her in spite of whether she was right or I was right. It didn't matter. I had to love her in spite of whether I could prove I was right. Sometimes it's more important for me to be obedient to God's word than it is for me to be right in an argument. Let me read the rest of that. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy. Wow. Cleansing her by the washing with water through the word. And to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. I don't know about you, but I love my body. I try to take pretty good care of it. I don't try to get into wrecks anymore like I used to when I was a kid. I see some of you smiling out there. You know exactly what I'm talking about. I want to preserve this temple that God has given me so that I will have the ability to serve him as long as I possibly can. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one hated his own body, but he feeds and cares for it. Some of us feed and care for it a little more than others. Just as Christ does the church, for we are all members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I'm talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. I always wondered why it tells husbands to love their wives and it tells wives to respect their husbands, but I found out through a lot of reading and studying, it is natural for a woman to love. It's part, women, it's actually part of your DNA to love. Men, it's part of our DNA to respect. You don't want to hang around another guy that does not show you respect. I don't hang around guys who fail to show any kind of respect towards me. You want to see a little respect when you're hanging out with someone. So God tells us men to respect our wives because it doesn't always come natural. Or it tells us to love our wives, I'm sorry. Love our wives because that does not always come natural for us men. We have to work at it. Women, it doesn't always come natural for you to respect your husband. But the Word of God puts it plainly in Scripture so that you can work on that because He knows that your husband needs respect. If you want to turn your husband completely off, let him come home after a day of work and totally disrespect him. Boy, I had a hard day at work today, honey. I bet you did. You think you had a hard day? You should have seen mine. That's disrespect in any way you want to put it. And I'm telling you, that will cause problems not only in the marriage, but it causes trouble in the church Remember, he said, this is a great mystery, and it's about the church, not just about marriage. We need to show love and respect in the church. Amen? What happens when we don't? Here's what happens. We stop living by the flesh, or stop living by the Spirit and start living by the flesh. Galatians chapter 5, starting with verse 16. So I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other, so that you do not do what you want. But if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. These acts of the sinful nature are obvious. Sexual immorality. Matt and I were talking this week, and I said, I'm not pointing out anybody or anything. I'm just saying, it's rare to marry a couple that has not been living or sleeping together. It's rare. It's an oddity. In church, we need to help these young couples understand that they can live a pure life. Paul clearly told us, I love this passage of Scripture. It's in, if you want to look it up real quick, it's 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, starting with verse 2. And it says this, I am jealous for you with a godly jealousy. I promised you to one husband, to Christ, so that I might present you as a pure virgin to him. Now let me tell you about the people in Corinth. They had these deities that they worshipped. And the way they worshipped them is every woman in the city of Corinth had to serve time as a temple prostitute. And you knew when her time was coming up because she would shave her head and would wear bells around her ankles. And you would know that she was on duty at the temple. And some men served as temple prostitutes. And when they did that, they let their hair grow out long. You know, I remember my dad using the verse that Paul, where Paul says it's a shame for men to have long hair. So in my house, if your hair touched your ears, buddy, you got it cut quick. Because they misunderstood the interpretation of that scripture. And quickly, you got your hair cut because it's not going to touch your collar. It's not going to touch your ears. But the real truth is, Paul was saying that because he didn't want you to be identified with those temple prostitutes. He wanted you to be identified with these people that he said, I'm jealous for you with a godly jealousy. He wanted them to repent. You don't have to continue in sin. Maybe you've been living in sin. But you can walk away from it today and know that God will accept your plea of repentance. And you can become pure as a virgin. I didn't write it. I'm just reporting on it. That's what God says. You can be clean as snow. Boy, that's good news, folks. Or if you choose to remain in, and I'm going to end with this, you can choose to remain in that type of fleshly sin. And here's what happens. For although they knew God, this is Romans chapter 1, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile. and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal man and birds and animals and reptiles. Therefore, God gave them over in the sinful desires of their heart to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another. Now, folks, this is as clear of an explanation on homosexual lifestyles as any place I can find in the Bible. And worshipped and served the Creator, the created things rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen. Now listen. Because of this, God gave them over to shameful lust. Even their women exchanged natural relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed indecent acts with other men and received in themselves the due penalty for their perversion. Furthermore, since they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, He gave them over to a depraved mind to do what ought not to be done. Does that sound like today? It was happening back then. It also sounds pretty familiar today. They have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. Young people, if you obey your parents, there's a promise attached to it, and it is this: you'll live a long life. They are senseless, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them. The good news is the word that I read in the book of Corinthians, and that is that through repentance, which you can experience today before we take communion, that God can clean your life up and He can make you whole again. He can make you white as snow. He can take your sins away and make you feel brand new. It's not a game. It's being played out in politics and played out in our culture as a game. But it's not a game. It's right and wrong. It's God or His enemy, the devil. It's good or evil. Which will you choose? Let's pray. Father, we are all too aware that our families are under attack, that the very moral fabric of our families and our homes is under attack. We recognize it, we know it. Help us, Lord, to stand, take a stand with You, and not allow the perversion and the perverse ways of this world to overtake our homes. But Lord, let us stand with You for righteousness. Let us stand with You for what Your word claims. God, help us to have a family Bible at our tables. And Lord, help us to get back into reading the word as a family together. Lord, help us to do what You say we need to do. Not what I say, my words are nothing, but yours lasts for eternity. Lord, today as a group of people, we declare that we love you and we need you. And we pray this prayer in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Keep your heads bowed just for a minute. If you've never really asked Christ into your heart, you've never made him Lord of your life, you never made him the ruler, he's the one who calls the shots in your life, would you please raise your hand? I want to pray for you this morning. Raise your hand. I'm not going to embarrass you. I just want you to raise your hand. That's awesome. We're all believers. How many of you would say, Pastor, we want our homes to be homes that glorify God, and we want you to pray for us, that we will have a home that stands for right and stands for you. If that's your prayer this morning, raise your hand. I want to pray for you. Hallelujah. Father, we come to you today, and you see these hands, and you know the hearts. People who want to stand for you at any cost. Lord, we know that we are soon to be under an attack like we've never seen before, because even our politicians are coming after our religious rights. And we see it every day. We hear it every day. We know it's happening. We know it's coming. But we know that greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. So, Lord, we call on you, the one who is greater, to stand with us and help us to be the overcomers that you have called us to be. That we will stand when it's hard to stand. That we will call out on your name and stand on your word and be people who the world sees as those who are willing to take a stand. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Chapter 12, and I feel it's very appropriate. I won't be reading it if I don't get these. Very appropriate for what we've been talking about this morning. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Did you know that you can know what God's will is for your life? You can. This morning, let's join together as we pray the prayer of confession. It will be on the screen or it's in your bulletin. You can follow along with us. But let's pray that prayer together. Almighty God, we praise you, our Creator and Redeemer, for forgiveness and salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. As the psalmist confessed, so do we now confess our sins and shortcomings to you. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I'm going to ask Tom Day if he would to pray over the bread this morning. John T., would you please pray over the cup?
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Holy Spirit, and Son Jesus Christ, we ask you to please bless this wine as a representation of your blood today. It was your blood, Jesus, that purchased for your Father people from every nation and language. Let us take this time to examine ourselves and to also thank you for the willing sacrifice of yourself for the forgiveness of our sins. Help us to take this opportunity you have given us to let you work in us and through us. I pray this in your holy name. Amen.
And before we partake of the elements, a couple of announcements. First of all, if you'd rather take grape juice, they're in the big purple cups in the center. If you're visiting with us today, we invite you, if you are a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, we invite you to participate with us. And if you would, hold the elements until everybody has been served, and we will take them together. Thank you. Thank you. the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat." So this is the cup of the new covenant in his blood. Take and drink. Father, what a privilege it has been to be in your house today, glorifying you. Father, I pray that we all leave here having been drawn closer to you through the power of your Holy Spirit. And Lord, let us have a week that gives us opportunities to share this good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the power of repentance and the power of right living. And Lord, let us take it to heart that we see righteousness, that we seek first your righteousness, and then all things will come to us. Lord, we thank you again for the opportunity to have been here this morning. Let us show each other fellowship, friendliness, and love as we leave here today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Will you please stand?
Of the saints. May we love us men, love our wives as Christ has loved the church, and may those wives honor their husbands and love their husbands as the church should love Jesus Christ. Please go in peace.